IVC filters used to prevent strokes are defective and dangerous. The FDA knows it and does nothing about it. See the story at drugsafetynews.com.
Thom, we're here at the Mass Torts Made Perfect Legal Conference. I want to thank you for taking the time to sit down with me, one of the smartest men in the business, absolutely. I always enjoy talking with you. And so I want to get your take. Last week, we had the New York primary. Did not go very well for Bernie Sanders. And so the path forward from this point, it's a very narrow path for Bernie Sanders. Statistically or technically, mathematically, there is still a way. But when you look at it, there doesn't seem to really be a way. I mean, unless he pulls out 100% in California and 100% in Pennsylvania. So I want to get your opinion on where the primaries go from here on the Democratic side.
It's at this particular moment in time, it's a tough one. I mean, next Tuesday is going to tell us a lot. You've got Pennsylvania and four other states, as I recall, that are doing primaries, and most of them are closed primaries, and so it's going to be a tough lift for Bernie in those situations. What I suggested on the air on Wednesday after he lost the New York primary, was that both campaigns, both the Clinton campaign and the Sanders campaign, should stop attacking each other, frankly. And I would point out, I think the more ad hominem types of attacks have been coming from the Clinton surrogates and the Clinton campaign explicitly. But there's also a lot of Bernie's followers, for lack of a better word, enthusiasts, have been pretty down in the mud. And you know, I think it's time to set that aside and have both candidates focus on the Republicans. And frankly, I think that's a better strategy for Bernie. I think when Bernie, you know, when after Wisconsin, after the loss in Wisconsin, and the Hillary memo was leaked that they were going to disqualify, discredit, and destroy Bernie Sanders, and then pick up, you know, the pieces later, put the party back together later. The Sanders campaign reacted to that pretty ferociously, which caused the Clinton campaign to back off. I think they thought they'd just, you know, kick his butt and that would be it. But her campaign shouldn't have done that. His campaign, in my opinion, should have reacted with derision rather than anger. Or something like that. And, you know, it's time for both of them to back off. The Republican Party represents an existential threat right now, not just to the United States, but to the entire planet. It's the only political party in the entire developed world that denies climate change exists, that won't do anything about it. They have totally bizarre opinions on the social safety net in the United States, on regulating and deregulating industry and businesses, things that almost certainly will throw us into a Great Depression if they get power. And, you know, there's lots and lots and lots of material to go after there. Yeah. And frankly, I think that when Bernie holds himself above the fray and speaks to that kind of John Kennedy high standard, he actually does better than when he gets down in the mud and says, oh, Hillary's not qualified. And so this would be the best thing, in my opinion, for both campaigns, because Bernie's going to stay in this until November, or until June, excuse me, because, or the convention is in July, I guess June is the California primaries, because he's pushing a movement rather than a candidacy, and movements don't go away.
Right.
And you know, that movement is going to continue whether Bernie's the nominee or not. So those are my thoughts on where it's at.
Well, here's the way I see it. If Hillary ends up becoming the nominee, and we're already seeing this talk from her surrogates that she is going to soundly defeat Trump or Cruz or Kasich or whoever the nominee might be. If it's Paul Ryan, she'll beat Paul Ryan.
Right.
There is a lot of arrogance. You know, spend a few minutes on Twitter, and you're going to see this overwhelming arrogance from some of the Clinton surrogates, because there's no way she can lose in their minds. Mm. Well, we thought the same thing back in 2004 with John Kerry.
Right.
We had George W. Bush, who had roughly a 50% approval rating. Mm. In the months before the election, millions of people marched against his wars, marched against his policies. Hugely unpopular, Democratic candidate was, you know, a little bit milquetoast, a little, you know, non-charismatic, but we thought we had this on lock. And then election day comes, and it's devastation. George W. Bush pulls it out. I mean, helped by voter suppression and purges in Ohio and Florida. And so I'm looking at this election, remembering 2004, and almost saying, like, guys, wake up. We've got some serious problems. It doesn't matter if it's Hillary or Bernie. We've got massive problems because we have 22 states that, you know, back in 2004, even 2012, did not have these laws. And so we're going to have Democrats all over this country not able to vote. Right. And so I think arrogance or you know, cockiness needs to go aside because we have real problems that are going to keep, you know, Democrats in half the states across this country from being able to cast a ballot. And that always hurts the Democratic Party.
Yeah. I remember my recollection is talking with John Edwards. It might have been one of the people on his staff. When Ohio was the deciding state, the vote had been cast, and there was some question about those votes. Ken Blackwell was apparently counting them on a server in Kentucky or Tennessee that was also the server that held over 4 or 5 million George W. Bush and Karl Rove emails that somehow vanished. You think Clinton has an email scandal? I mean, this is huge. And Edwards was furious. He wanted Kerry to force a recount. And Kerry was like, you know, it's like, let's move on. And so, you know, there are levels of forces against us. I also remember, you know, 1980. I'm a generation older than you. I remember that really, really well, that in 1980 when Ronald Reagan was nominated, you know, against a sitting president, the Democratic president, Jimmy Carter, we were all going, this is in the bag, you know. There's no way America's going to elect this guy. He destroyed the University of California system. We called him Ronnie Reagan, you know. He had all these weird stories about how he'd been there liberating Auschwitz when he wasn't even in the, you know, in the service, and et cetera. I mean, it was just, and he won. So don't take anything for granted. Complacency on the Democratic side, regardless of our candidate, is insane. And that's another reason why I think both candidates now need to focus all of their energy on the Republicans instead of each other, Bernie and Hillary. Because they could, if they did that, they could reduce the probabilities of the scenario that you're describing, which is that, you know, whichever Republican comes out of this actually might win the presidency.
Well, I think what's interesting too is that people may not even realize, but there is so much at stake in this election, not just in terms of, you know, fighting inequality or equal rights, equal pay, but we have an environment that for the last 8 years, we really thought President Obama was going to come out and be super strong on protecting the environment and, you know, taking action against climate change. And we didn't really get that. For every step forward President Obama made, we took two steps backward. You know, we get this EPA power plant rule. That's phenomenal. However, at the same time, they leased out enough coal mining leases to completely negate all of the gains that would have been made. So, another example, after the BP oil spill said, okay, look, this deep water offshore moratorium is in place, no more new wells. That lasted for less than 90 days. Nobody reported on the fact that it was lifted after 90 days. All we had was misinformation from the oil industry saying, look, they're going to kill the industry, even though they were still able to operate all their other rigs. Right. So I think the environment is a huge issue this year because we've just gone another 8 years of very little action. And at this point, we don't have another 4 years to not do anything, or 8 years, or 16, however many it may be. It's time now, and I don't see Hillary Clinton, and certainly not any of the Republicans, as someone who's going to take that challenge as seriously as it needs to be taken.
The definition of a politician in my mind is not a, quote, leader. The word leader doesn't appear in our Constitution. Instead, it's the word representative. A good politician represents the people. And if the people, if enough of us create a parade going down the street, metaphorically speaking, you know, a good politician will jump in front of that parade with a flag and say, this is my parade. So if we want energy, a change on, you know, how we're using energy, the environment, you know, solarize America the way Germany did Germany, stuff like that, then regardless of who the nominee is for president, we need to push that. We need to push it hard. It's also something that to really do anything serious and consequential about is going to require Congress. And so, you know, however you may feel about whoever ends up at the top of the Democratic ticket, it's still critically important to vote, even if you're just voting down to, you know, I hear people say, oh, I'll never vote for Hillary. I say, fine, go into the voting booth and vote for every other Democrat. And odds are they'll vote for Hillary too, because, yeah, you know, back 8 years ago, more than 50% of Hillary voters, when asked in an exit poll on May 8th in 2008 by CNN, would you vote for Barack Obama? They said, no, there's no way. Well, you know, it didn't quite work out. But, and it's not, and the environment, like I said earlier, I think this is one of the critical issues of our time. I mean, we're starting to see tipping points pass. We've already passed the tipping point for an ice-free Arctic. That has already altered weather patterns all over, you know, certainly in my part, in my neck of the woods in D.C., it's altering weather patterns in Europe. It's like very, very, very bad positive feedback loops are starting to occur in the whole global warming scenario, and that's a dangerous thing. The other thing to keep in mind, you know, people say, oh, it's the Supreme Court, you know. Well, yeah, it's the Supreme Court, but it's also the Federal Election Commission. It's also the Federal Trade Commission. It's also the FCC. It's also the EPA. It's also the Department of Housing. It's the Department of Education. It's the Labor Department, and whether or not we're, you know, I mean, Reagan kind of broke the mold because he was the first president to appoint, you know, Bill Bennett, who ran on a campaign when he was running for president of abolishing the Department of Education. Reagan put him in charge of the Department of Education. You know, Reagan's the guy who was running, James Watt, who was running the Interior Department that, you know, manages all the public lands. He was selling public lands off at pennies on the dollar. And when they asked him why, he said, well, because very soon Jesus is going to come back and make all things new. So it doesn't matter if they ruin the public lands. I mean, honest to God, you know, these are the people that Reagan put in, you know, in his cabinet and put in charge of these, you know, giant agencies that are supposed to be protecting this country. And enormous damage was done and has continued to be done by Republican presidents since then. It's been somewhat mitigated, you know, during the Clinton years and during the Obama years. But as you correctly point out, you know, so much more needs to be done and isn't being done. And so this, you know, once again gets it back to, you know, Bernie's leading a movement, not just a candidacy. And that movement needs to continue. We need to keep pushing. We need to keep focusing. People need to show up at their local Democratic Party and say, I want to be a precinct committee person. You know, we're going to do what the Tea Party did. You know, they infiltrated the Republican Party and took over enough of it that now they're the tail that wags the dog at the entire party. Progressives could do the same damn thing with the Democratic Party, and it's not a secret how to do it. It's real simple. You just have to get off your butt and get out there and participate.
Yeah, that's probably the best way to put that is you have to do it. You.
Yeah.
Every individual watching this, listening to this, if you're going to stay silent and stay home and just say, well, this, I'm so mad about all this, that doesn't help. And the people who say, well, I'm just not going to vote because I'm not happy, that does a lot of damage. Because Joshua Holland actually wrote a great piece about this. You're not sending a message to the Democratic Party establishment. They're going to be just fine, whether they win or lose. In fact, they may even be in better shape if they lose because they're going to be able to fundraise off of whoever the Republican president is.
That's correct.
So you're sending a message to no one. You're punishing yourself.
Or you're sending a message to the predators in corporate America.
Right.
That it's fine if you just keep on doing this stuff. Keep raping the, robbing and pillaging the earth, you know. Keep on ripping us all off. Banksters, keep doing your stuff. You know, yeah, if you don't vote, that's the message that you're sending. And it's a horrible message.
It is. And so I think the Democratic Party itself needs to be a little bit more active in helping to get out the vote.
A lot more active. Well, I mean, you know, the Deputy Wasserman Schultz leadership of the DNC, I think, has been a disaster. We've lost over 900 state house and Senate seats. We've lost a bunch of states. We lost the House. We lost the Senate. They're not following Howard Dean's 50-state strategy. They ridicule it. It's, you know, the Democratic Party needs a reboot. And again, that's only going to happen if we can get a lot of progressives elected. And getting a lot of progressives elected means showing up to vote.
Right. Well, and when you think about it, you mentioned the Tea Party. We had the Koch brothers funding through Americans for Prosperity, you know, buses to take people to these rallies. The Democratic Party, they have money, maybe not as much as the Koch brothers have kicking around. But why are we not funding buses to take people to go get this photo ID? It is unfortunately the law in these places. So let's round them up. Let's pay for these photo IDs. Sometimes it's $5 or $10, but they don't have a way to get there. Right. Let's help these people get what they need and really stick it to the Republicans who are trying to keep them away from the polls. Those are the people that we can teach a lesson to. The Democratic Party, as it is right now, refuses to learn.
Yeah.
So,
well, what you're talking about is just the, you know, in this day and age, the next logical step of get out the vote. The Democratic Party knows how to, you know, pick up people from their homes if they don't have a car or if they're disabled and drive them to the polls. They know that. But they haven't figured out that you also have to, you know, get people registered, and you also have to make sure that the registrations are consistent, and you need to, you know, and you need to help people basically get out in the streets and make some noise.
This election is about Bernie Sanders' movement. Whether or not he is the nominee, he has created something that shouldn't go away, but it will go away if the people who support him just say, well, we lost.
Yeah.
You didn't lose. I mean, you look at what's happening right now. You look at the stories. You won.
Yeah. The Democratic Party has been changed forever.
It has. And that's what's so important. And it was people. I mean, it wasn't, I mean, I love Bernie Sanders, but it wasn't him. It was the fact that he understands what the people want, and they finally said, we can do this.
Right.
And if that mentality stays, I think we have a real potential, regardless of who the next president is, of making real change, both in the Democratic Party and in the United States.
Yeah. The Progressive Change Campaign Committee, PCCC, paid for an amazing poll about 6 months ago. I know that you've talked about it on Ring of Fire, where they asked Americans, you know, which policies do you want? Do you want stronger Social Security? Do you want stronger Medicare? Do you want the right to unionize? Do you want, you know, and they put together this list, and virtually every plank in Bernie's platform, as it were, if you go to feeltheburn.org, where there's a really good list of all of his explicit, you know, campaign positions, virtually all of them are the things that came out well over 50% of all Americans in that PCCC poll. And it wasn't that Bernie said, oh, this is what people want, so I'm going to give it
right.
to them. He had always been there. America has now caught up with him. And that's, you know, that's what we need to be pushing, I think, frankly. And that's that movement, you know, it really is not about Bernie Sanders. And Bernie would be the first to tell you this, you know. 20-year-old Americans, you know, young Americans, millennials, have not been sitting around going, gee, I wish a 74-year-old Jewish guy would run for president. Wouldn't that be great? You know, no, that, I mean, you know, those are actually challenges, you know, that he will have to face. Instead, it's been his message, and his message is not a message that is specifically unique to Bernie. You've got that same message coming out of the entire House Progressive Caucus, which Bernie co-founded. It's the second largest caucus in all of Congress. We need to be working to keep those people in office, to add to that Progressive Caucus, to bring new people in. And the other point is that if you look at your members of Congress, or you look at people even, you know, running for the White House or the Senate, I don't know if it's most, but many of them, probably most of them, started running for the school board. Started running for city council. You know, these are not inconsequential races.
Right.
This is the farm team. You know, this is this generation's farm team to be able to take power, you know, a decade or two decades down the road. And so it's not enough just to vote, even. You have to show up and participate, and we need young people in particular inside this process. So show up and help infiltrate the Democratic Party and take the damn thing over, and let's turn it into a genuinely progressive party. I believe it can be done.
Absolutely. Thom Hartmann, it's wonderful speaking with you. Thank you for taking the time to talk to us today. Thank you for coming out to Mass Towards Made Perfect. And I look forward to the next time we get to do this again.
It's a pleasure and an honor, Farron. Thank you.
Thank you.